school, I was on a co-op program that I'd leave like at 1:30 and I'd sell clothes till about 7. I'd deliver pizza at night during the week, and then on weekends I would play fraternity parties. In the sense that I grew up not rich, not even remotely. Matter of fact, at one point, my mother and my brother and I were living in one room about this size, and it's not very big in here, and it was two bunk beds and a hot plate, no refrigerator, no nothing. This was when I was 10 years old. So from the sense that I came out of near poverty to where I am today, I guess I think people can relate to that. Songwriting, to me, I really, really try overtly to not write autobiographically. I really do. I find if I do write autobiographically, it can get maudlin, it can get melodramatic, and I think it's better. Don Henley kind of calls it reporting. It is a big voice. It can get very large. I was doing a Randy Newman session. He called me, but I love Randy, and I love his music, and his producers called me and said, "Why don't you just sing with Randy?" And so I actually, Henley was instrumental in that, too, because he was going down there the same day. And at one point, they said, you know, I was just singing harmony and trying to stay out of the way and not dominate anything, and they said, "Come on, Bob, we want to see your voice." Oh, you want the mountain voice. I started pouring it on and like rattling speakers and everything, and you couldn't hear Randy anymore. It's great to own that instrument, you know, and it's something that you have to take good care of. It's another aspect about being on the road. I've got to be very, very quiet on the road. It's a very disciplined thing. It's not a good idea to talk a lot, to go to any kind of nightclub and talk over the music. These are all bad things for your voice. So I live a rather Spartan existence on the road. I go straight to the room, get a lot of rest. The old axiom about a singer needing an extra amount of sleep is really true. You know, you're out there for the fans. And they're spending money, they're coming from maybe 100, 200 miles away to see you in some city, okay? And they live, let's say, you live in southern Indiana and you're playing in Indianapolis. It is an effort for them. So every night you have got to have that sort of thinking. You got to say, you know, these people deserve my best. And whatever it takes for me to do my best, I've got to go out there and be I'm responsible for these people coming and spending their money and taking time off work, whatever. These are responsibilities, you know, so you got to live up to them. And it comes to you how it all slips away. Youth and beauty are gone one day. No matter what you dream or feel or say, it ends in dust and disarray. Like wind on the plains, sand through the glass, waves rolling in with the tide. Dreams die hard and we watch them erode, but we cannot be denied.
You said a lot of anticipation. It has been 4 years.
Yeah.
You had a lot of things going on in your own life for a while, which kind of prevented you from recording.
Uh-huh.
Do you think that reflects on the album?
I'm sure it does. I try not to let it reflect on the album, but I'm sure it creeps in there, subconsciously into your lyrics. But, like my mother's death, which was a long situation. 50 years ago, she had TB, and back then, 50, 60 years ago, the only way they could treat it was just to collapse the lung. So she lived her whole life with one lung. And eventually, it caught up to her in her 70s, and she got respiratory problems. Never smoked. This woman who never smoked, you know, wasn't anything like that. And so it was like a long, kind of a three-year downhill slide for her. And we're a very small family. My father died in 68. My brother has a wife and three kids and lives in North Carolina. It kind of fell to me to carry the ball for about three of those years. And she was in and out of hospitals. And then the final year was a total year in the hospital, and we literally went and saw her every day.
Yeah,
it was kind of a sad thing. But it's one of those things where you have to literally stop everything. And it's just, I know I'm not unique in this. This happens to a lot of people, you know, everywhere. But it's just one of those situations where the career just has to go on hold for a while.